Started and stopped recording. Don't make any change in the settings. Huh? This is A, B, epsilon. This is B. This is A, epsilon, 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 epsilon. Okay, let us work out this. So is it correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now let us number this.
Yes, sir.
0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, correct? Fine. Now what is the epsilon closure of 0? So we are constructing now DFA using subset construction. So 0, 1, 2, 6, 9, 10, 12, and 13. Correct? Am I right?
Yes, yes, sir.
Okay, good. So let us work out. So this would be A. Correct? Mark A. I assume I haven't solved this example. Na? Have I solved it?
No, sir. This was for the assignment.
No, sir.
That was for assignment. Na?
I got the same answer.
Okay, okay. Let us see. So mark A, input A. What would be T? Correct?
Yes, sir.
So epsilon closure would be 3, 4, 10, 11, 12, and 13. Correct. 3, 4, 10, 11, 12, 13. Correct. Very good. Input B, T. Only 7. Fine. Epsilon closure of T. 7, 8, 13. Correct. This is C. So mark B. Let us see like what we get. Okay. So her answer might be correct, but let us verify it so that everyone can verify whether is their solution is correct or wrong. And so the regular expression that we are working is this one, AB plus B plus A star. So mark B, B is this. So as 3, 4 is involved, so 2 cannot be taken. 10 is involved, that's why 11 is to be taken. Correct? T for B now. So we don't have 6, we have 4, so that's why 5. So what it would be? 5, 8 and 13, correct? So this would be E. Now mark C. Input A, T, 7, 8, 13. So this is phi. Correct? Input B. It would be phi, correct? For both the cases?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now mark D. Input A, what is T? Now D is 10, 11, 12, 13. So this would be 11, correct? Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
So this would be, already we computed it. So this would be D. Fine? Input B is 5. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Correct? Okay. Mark E. Input A, input B. T. 5, 8, 13. 5. Correct? This would be 5. So we don't have anything. So if you see what, as per what Rutuja said, 13, 13, 13, 13, 13, all of them are in the same group. So let me draw this. A, B, C, D, and E. So this one, fine. Then from B, D to E. For C, there is no outgoing transition, correct? For D, there is only one outgoing, which is self loop with A. And for E, we don't have anything, correct? Okay, so let us mark each one is final. So you have this initial. Okay, now we have to write their inputs. Sorry, this is A, B. So B is accepted, A, and this is from B with A, it is going here. And from A, B, it is going here, and this is A. So this results to A star, this results to A, B, this results to B. Now you don't have any non-final state, so all of them are final. So you are having A, B, C, D, and E. Correct. There is no transition, like going to outside, because all states are final in this case. So you will have this A only. You will have only two transitions. One is A, one is B, and then you have this. But let us see, like whether have we solved it correctly? Because if you see this result, what would be the output of this result? If I give only one state to this, okay, because all of them are non-final. This is one of the tricky example that you have. Can I write like this? I can get a string BA using this, correct? Can I get BA?
Yes, sir.
But then BA doesn't fit into my case. BA doesn't fit here. It should be either AB or B or A star. Correct? Are you with me? Then what should be done?
Yes, sir.
In this case. what should be done in this case. So have we like everyone's answer looks to be similar. Everywhere we got 13.
Sir, but the DFA seems to be right because that would only allow A, B, B and A star. The diagram in red, the DFA diagram.
This one, na? This is correct, but this minimization is failing somewhere. Correct? This minimization is failing somewhere. Why? Now, like when we are working with this, if one of the set is empty while you are constructing this finite automata stuff, so in such a case, this algorithm never works. There should be at least one state in this side. Okay, whatever the pi that we got. Otherwise, if you go with this, what you will be doing, you will be you will be writing only one state here, correct? And all transitions would be added here. But if I see this, I can accept BA as well. So whenever you are constructing these sets, one to be final and one to be non-final, in some cases, or rather you can say in every case, do not work with minimization algorithm when one of the set is empty. Now, which one set I'm talking about? Which one set I'm talking about? You have two groups here, correct? One group is final, other group is non-final, correct? So in this case, non-final is empty, final is there. So you cannot work with this. Why? Because if you work with this, then you would be getting something which where the language part is not same for with both these cases. Both these cases, you will not see that language is same for them. Now in such a case, then you are not supposed to apply subset construction for this kind of problem. So there should be a statement we should mention somewhere that, like whenever you see some situation where one of the group, when you are applying this minimization algorithm, if one of the group is empty, then do not proceed with subset construction because it will not lead to what was expected. This is not because if you do this, now you may say like this looks fine, correct? If I go with this strategy by converting this to a single state. But when I add two transitions, then it is completely ruining my original regular expression because this can give me B star as well. Am I right? Is it going to give B star?
Yes, sir.
Check it. Correct. Now, if it is going to give me B star, then this language is not preserved. Whatever the regular expression that we are talking about is not preserved. Then what should we do? This cannot be particularly applied in such a case. Correct? Let me see if I can open a book. Rather. So NFA to DFA. Okay, so I'm sharing screen from my other laptop. Oh, sorry, other machine. Check this one. Okay, so the subset construction algorithm is given like this. This is a book by Aulman. Okay, this one is the title: Compilers, Principles, Techniques and Tools, Second Edition. Alfred Aho, Monica Lam, Ravi Sethi, Jeffrey Ullman. So let me go to this one. So this is the third chapter where exactly a few things are worked out, where it talks about, where compiler also talks about this part. Every compiler book should have such kind of stuff. So let me go to this page where I have this subset construction. This is the algorithm that you see initially. Like to start state of D, is epsilon closure of initial state. So if you see that it is using some kind of notation which is somewhat different than how I explained, but you can see that there is a for loop and then it is taking this set where you are computing epsilon closure for each element. Okay, and then you have minimization simulating NFA efficiency implementation construction of that's what we talked about, how to construct NFA for given regular expression. So this is epsilon, this is A, this is A plus B, correct? This is AB, this is A star, fine. Okay, so let's see where I can get subset construction. No, not subset construction, but minimization. I don't know why it is not highlighting, but let me see if I can get contents from here. Yeah, so this is the example A plus B star ABB. They have taken this example, A plus B star ABB. This is one of the famous example. So like whenever you are so you do this initially, you construct pi new. Start with an initial partition pi with two groups F and S minus F. Means this S is your complete set of states. Complete, and F is there. So that means what? Accepting and non-accepting means final and non-final. That's what they are using the terminology. So apply the procedure. Like this is the procedure. So initially let pi new would be phi. For each group G in pi, partition G into subgroups such that two states S and T are in the same subgroup if and only if for all input symbols A, states S and T have transition on a state in the same group of pi. At worst, a state will be in the subgroup by itself. Replace G by pi new. That's what the method that we applied. Now nowhere it mentioned about some situation like the one that we are seeing. Okay, because it is assuming always that there would be F and S minus F, the initial partition. So if you read this particular thing, like that what it said, a DFA D with set of states S, input alphabet sigma and start state S0, and set up accepting states means final states to be F. So you are constructing minimization like this. And so let me share this with you people so that you also can download this later. Click it if you see and if you can open it. See if you can open. Can you open that?
So it's showing an option of download.
Yeah, so download it. You can download. So because this is one of the book that you should keep in your library. Okay, with assumption that you are going to read it, not now, but definitely sometime. So in that book, in that algorithm, this kind of case is never handled. Okay, so what exactly you are going to do? You are not going to apply what I was telling you. The example which we started with. Okay, if I see such an example, whenever I do see one of the set to be empty, don't proceed with the construction. This algorithm fails there. Because first step that you must have seen, we started with Q minus F and F. So Q minus F would be non-final and F would be your final. But in this case, this is empty. So that's why this algorithm cannot be worked out. So this procedure is not to be applied. So you, this code doesn't, or this DFA doesn't require minimization. You cannot. But in some situations you may see, like for example, if you, this is your example, A plus B star. Now you will get minimized DFA like this. See, it is working, it is accepting everything. It is accepting A, it is accepting B, it is accepting combinations, it is accepting epsilon 2. But when you are talking about such, this A plus B star, like if you see, this and this one was similar, correct? That's what I have drawn now. But the language that this regular expression is representing and this regular expression is representing is completely different. Fine. So there are always exceptions. So some code cannot be optimized. Some set of codes cannot be optimized. Is that fine now, Rutuja?
Yes, sir. Yes,
so fine. Whenever you see such situation, you try to see if you can get, like for this example, you definitely would be getting this, or you can keep as it is, whatever the DFA that you got for this A plus B star. You may get that. You can keep it as it is, so not, may not be necessary for you, you rather, to optimize that further. It would be automatically done. Is that fine? Any other question, query that you had in your mind, rather about this subset and minimization?
Oh, sir, a question about the regular expression. So yes, A plus B, A plus B star is the same as A star plus B star, right?
Okay, as per the properties, na? That's what you are talking about, na?
Yeah.
So this one, okay. A plus B star equal to A star plus B star, A star plus B star.
Okay.
But when you are talking about this, na? Like if you have this star, then it is different. Because always you are going to get pairs of AB, AB, AB only.
Yes.
But whenever it is, there is plus, then there's opportunity. So you may see here, when it says this equal to this, then it has star for both. It is not only P, Q, bracket star, the way that I already wrote for AB star. Fine? Any question?
No, sir.
No? So can we proceed then? So anybody having any query, question again about subset construction? If not, we can move further. Okay, now recall this one. If you recall, we saw these identities, I think on 8th. Okay, these identities on 8th, we saw them. Now, these identities, we are going to make use of some of them. Fine. So when we are saying some of them, I am going to introduce to you one important theorem, okay, which is used into in, like for example, with respect to, now what we saw was, we have been given regular expression, we constructed a FA, correct? Now we have been given regular expression like this, then we constructed FA, DFA. What if I have been given this, can I construct a regular expression from it? So we are talking about now reverse procedure. So for that purpose, I will require to introduce to you one important theorem, okay, which is mostly used, rather, or mostly introduced in every group or every book per se. Fine. So let me write its statement. So with assumption that you are now Arden's, the subset construction and every other thing is clear to you now. So let me proceed through the theorem. Okay, so I am talking about Arden's theorem. Fine. Now let me write the statement. Let P and Q B, 2 regular expressions over your input set sigma if P does not contain epsilon, means P never can be epsilon. Fine. Then following equation in R, that is R equal to Q plus RP, has a unique solution given by R equal to QP star. So whenever you get some expression or regular expression like this Q plus RP, then you certainly can write it directly as QP star with the assumption that you are going to get it with R. So you will see that, like in implementation, like when we said we are constructing regular expression for the given FA, in that situation you would be getting similar kind of expressions, okay, where you are going to convert it. Fine. So let us try to prove this. Now we will require these identities. So if you have written those identities on some page, please keep that page in front of you. So we are going to make use of, let me see which one would be. So we are going to make use of this one. Okay, this ninth one here only. Okay, let us see. Fine. Okay. So I have an expression R equal to Q plus RP. So let me replace this R by this QP star. So what I will get? Q plus RP. So let me replace this by QP star. So what I will get? Q plus QP star P. Correct? Correct. So what it means? It is like Q plus QP star P. Am I right? So if I take Q common, it would be epsilon plus P star P. Am I right? So if you see this definition, epsilon plus PP star or epsilon plus P star P. So in this case, I took R. So this results to R star. So that means what? Using that identity 9. Using I9. Now this I9 is the one which I am talking about, this one, which already we saw. Okay. So using I9, I can write this as QP star. That means what? This expression R equal to Q plus RP is satisfied when R equal to QP star, because you are getting that here by replacing value of R. That's what you write in mathematics. Na? This expression Q plus RP, R equal to Q plus RP satisfied whenever you have R equal to QP star, because if I put this, then I am going to get this solution only. That's why. But now we have to prove its uniqueness, that this is only, like, because we have mentioned here, has a unique solution. This is the solution that we got. Correct. So you can say, hence equation R equal to Q plus RP is satisfied when R equal to QP star. Correct, which means R equal to QP star is a solution. But the statement said we should have an unique solution. Now here we replaced R by QP star. Let us replace R by same value now, okay, because we have to prove uniqueness. So to prove uniqueness, replace R by Q plus RP. One, RHS of R equal to Q plus RP. So what you will get? Q plus RP is equal to Q plus, now what it would be? Q plus RP P. Am I right? So what can, how can I write this? Q plus QP plus RPP. Is that fine? So if I go on doing replacing R every time by Q plus RP, Q plus RP. So I will get something like this. Q plus QP plus QP square probably. Correct? Plus dot 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 plus RP raised to I plus 1. And last, before this would be QP raised to I. QP raised to I plus RP raised to I plus 1. Now, if I take Q common here, it would be epsilon plus P square dot 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 P raised to I plus RP raised to I plus 1. Am I right?
Yes, sir.
Any problem with till this? Now, for every I that we are having with greater than equal to 0. For every I greater than equal to 0, I am going to get this. Correct? So this would be R equal to, this is for Q plus RP. So as Q plus RP we have written with R, so I can directly write this R equal to Q epsilon plus P square plus dot 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 plus P raised to I plus RP raised to I plus 1 for every I greater than equal to 0. Now think of this, like when we read this problem statement or theorem statement, it started by saying this P does not contain epsilon. What that means?
That means there is no transition there.
No, no, no. If P doesn't contain epsilon, that means what? This side, if this P doesn't contain epsilon, so this will have at least one element. Correct. And then plus 1. Means if P has I, then always it is going to be I plus 1. So there would not be any string less than I plus 1. So if I is 0, if you take I to be 0, there would be always I plus 1. Because R is already there. We haven't said anything about R. But this always would be, like if you say P doesn't have epsilon at all. So this cannot be epsilon. This P cannot be epsilon. Am I right? With respect to this statement, P does not contain epsilon. So if P doesn't, is not epsilon, that means there would be at least one element over there. Right? And it will never have less than I plus 1 elements in this side. R can be empty. We don't care. But P raised to I plus 1 will never be empty. It will always have I plus 1 elements. Correct? Now, when we are talking about uniqueness, we have to prove, like for every string, it is going to work out. Fine. So, can I say this? When we said that R equal to Q plus RP is satisfied when R equal to QP star. In that case, this also gets satisfied. because it is a solution and we are getting something. Now we have to prove uniqueness. So how can we do that? So let us take string w. Let w be a string of length to be I in R. So this R, right, left side. If R contains W, which is I, if R contains W, whose length is I, correct? So PK never can be empty. So that means it would be at least one. It's 1 plus 1, 2. So you will never get this length less than I plus 1. Fine. So length I, W be a string of length I in the set R, you can say R. Then W belongs to the set. Which is that set? This 2 epsilon plus p plus p square plus dot 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 plus p raised to I plus rp raised to I plus 1. Because if it is in R, that means W belongs to this set. If it is in R, then it means somewhere it is going to see, you are going to get it somewhere here. Moreover, as p does not contain epsilon, rp raised to I plus 1 has no strings less than I plus 1. On what basis we are saying this? If W is I and which is in R, so if P does not contain epsilon, this will never have any length less than I plus 1, this set, correct? Because R already had W and P is not epsilon. Are you with me? See, we started with assumption. Let W be a string of length I. Are you with me, everyone, please?
Yes, sir.
So if W is a string with length I, which is in R, then whenever we are talking about RP raised to I plus 1, W is already there on this side. So if I talk about this P raised to I plus 1 and P is not empty, that means at least this P will have length to be 2. Means one element at least, minimum one would be there with P. That means I is 1, 1 plus 1, 2. So this would be I plus 2. But our length is W. Our length is I for W, which is an R. So this W, or when you talk about this W, this will never be in this set, RP raised to I plus 1, because length of W itself is I. It can never be part of this set. Fine. So as P does not contain epsilon, RP raised to I plus 1 has no strings less than I plus 1. And so W is not in RP raised to I plus 1. Now, if it is not in RP raised to I plus 1, but it is a part of R, na? So if it is not here, then ultimately it lies here. It lies here somewhere. We don't know whether Q would be Q and this I, number of items for P. Where exactly W occurs? So it would be definitely occurring within this set, because if it doesn't occur here, then it occurs here. So we can discard this part. We don't care, because if you go on replacing this, your I may vary in each and every time. Correct. So what exactly this means? This means. W belongs to
q
bracket epsilon plus p plus p square plus dot 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 p raised to I. And hence qp star. Correct. Now we are assuming that it is in R. That's why we can say that's why we could prove that it is not in RP raised to I plus 1. But now our example started with Q plus RP. Now if it is not in Q plus RP, like if it is part of this, then if I start with other way around, if it is part of, because R equal to QP star, so I have to prove that here too. How can I do that? Because here my assumption was it is in R. When it is in R, and if its solution is R equal to QP star, then it should lie here as well. Now let me go in the reverse method. Okay, so I am writing here in continuation. Okay, I may be able to complete it over here only. Okay, now as I proved that this means W belongs to this set, and that's what I am saying. But now let me go in a reverse manner, on the other way around. Consider, okay, a string W again in the set QP star. Because earlier we said it would be in R. Now let us assume that it is in QP star. Then W, now because W's length is I. W's length is I. So I have to assume now W is in the set QP raised to K for some K return equal to 0. And we want length to be I, because if I assume I, this will never work. Correct, in this case. That's why we are working on the other way around. And hence, Q bracket epsilon plus P plus P square. Now, as we said, P raised to K, QPK. And hence in here. So if W, then W is in the set QP raised to K for some K greater than equal to 0, and hence in this set too. Correct. So W would be always in RHS of this equation, RP raised to I plus 1. Either here, like, because it will never lie here. If it is in R, then it occurs this side as well. So let me give this to be equation number 2 for understanding purpose, and this to be equation number 1. So equation number 1 for me is this one, R equal to Q plus RP. And equation number 2 is this one. Right, so always W would be in RHS of this equation. And therefore, as it is occurring to this side as well, and we said that its solution is this one, and we proved that QP star also can contain W. So that's why R and QP star would be representing the same set. So you will understand this probably in the implementation of this Arrhidius theorem. Correct. So let me show you, like, I don't know whether is it capturable in a single frame. Let me try doing it with mobile. If I can capture this in a single frame. Let me share this photo with you people. Okay. I'm sharing right now in WhatsApp. but I will upload definitely that in Moodle as well. So check WhatsApp group. I have shared this. Okay, it will get uploaded. Yeah. Now we will see like how we can use this Arden's theorem. Rather, whenever we get some situation like this r equal to q plus rp, then we will simply write that equation by qp star. Okay. So let me work out. So we'll be talking about now what you can call it as using this particular Arden's theorem. Can we convert NFA, convert in the sense, can we construct a regular expression for the given NFA? So the method is given a name something like this. Algebraic, BRAIC, algebraic method using Arden's theorem. Fine. Now you are assuming that like whenever you are applying this, you have to always assume, or you have to consider first few assumptions. So let us consider these assumptions to apply this or to implement this. Okay, so this method would be extension to what the theorem that we saw this side. It is extension to this. Okay, how can we use that unique solution formula here? So assumptions regarding the given transition system. Now this you are going to make use of for constructing a regular expression for the given transition diagram or given finite automata. It could be NFA, it could be DFA, but there are restrictions. So let us find some assumptions. Okay, so let me go with by writing assumptions one by one. So first assumption, the given FA, in bracket you can say transition graph or transition diagram, does not have epsilon moves. This first assumption. If whenever you are asked to construct a regular expression for a FA which is containing epsilon moves, directly straightforward say we cannot construct, and if it is mentioned that using algebraic method of Arden's theorem or using Arden's theorem, then you directly mention that this cannot be done. Okay, second thing, the given FA has only one state to be an initial state. Now you may say, every time whenever we talked about finite automata, we always said there is only one initial state. We never talked about that there are more than one initial state. But there can be some situations. Okay. Now about which are we talking in our next session, where I will tell you, whenever you talk about a program, there is always one entry point, single entry point inside the program. There are not more than one entry point. Otherwise, what will happen? How do you know from where to enter into the program for translation purpose? So it requires that every programming language should have a single entry point. There can be multiple exit points, but single entry point should be there. Fine. Okay, let me say third. The states are represented as Q0, Q1, Q2, ... Qn. Okay. So now fourth one. Let me denote a notation VI. This is a regular expression representing set of strings, correct, accepted by the system even though QI is a final state. Okay, fifth. Now we are denoting alpha IJ. Okay, it is bit mathematical. That's what name is given. It is for confusion purpose. So you will understand this very simply. I will write this only today. In next exam, next session, would be exactly seeing how one can translate the given transition diagram into expression the way that I'm writing now. Alpha IJ denotes a regular expression representing the set of labels, like labels would be like from edge I to node I to node j. So that's what when edge from labels of edge, or you can say transition from QI to QJ. Okay, when there is no edge, there is no such edge, then alpha IJ equal to phi. Okay, now if I try writing these equations for respective VIs, from V1 to VN, correct? Because V0 to VN, for example, in this case. Okay, so we can get following set of equations for in this V0. Why I'm saying V0? Because I have mentioned that my states are Q0 to Qn. That's why V0 to Vn. Fine, because this Vi would be for Qi. So V0 would be for Q0, Vn would be for Qn. That's what. So let us write V0 first. So V0 alpha. Now you are going to say what? 10 plus means what? I to J, na? So we are assuming that way. Now see the direction, by the way. Okay, so let me write next thing. So V1 alpha zero. So sorry, I have written this. Sorry, I made a mistake. V0 equal to V0 alpha 0,0 plus V1 alpha 1,0 plus ... Vn alpha n0. This is not new, n0. And now with assumption that you are talking this V0 for your initial state, because V0 is representing for Q0. So for initial state, you have to write epsilon plus epsilon. Now you have V1. So let us write this V1. We are going to start with V0 only. V0 alpha 01 plus V1 alpha 11 plus dot 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 Vn alpha n1. Similarly, if I have now Vn, it would be V0 alpha 0n, correct, plus V1 alpha, what you will write, 1n plus dot 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 plus Vn alpha nn. Fine. So now whenever you get these expressions, so these expressions repeatedly you have to apply the Arden's theorem. R equal to Q. Now you can see R equal to, suppose this is Q, this R and R, this V0 is same here, this V1 is same here, this Vn is same here. So you are going to get definitely a situation where R equal to Q plus R, that R and R will match. Correct? Okay, so we'll be using this in the implementation. So do you want me to take example today, or should we take that on Saturday? You can let me know, because it will take nearly say 30 minutes for a while rather to understand this. So you suggest me appropriately, I will do that.
Sir, let's take this on Saturday.
Okay. So I will be adding this now in your WhatsApp group. Okay, right now. So let me stop this and we will continue in Saturday session.